Either that or I got to start eating more Wheaties in the morning. Good morning, everybody. Really great to have you here this morning. So glad you have joined us for worship here. Thank you so much to our worship team for leading us as well and getting us to be able to stand in the presence of God, being able to give Him the glory this morning. The shortest distance between two places, right? What is it? It's a straight line, isn't it? It's a straight line. It certainly is not a long and winding road. It is a straight shot. That is the shortest way to go. When we travel as a family, when our kids were little in particular, going on family vacations, I always want to take the shortest route possible. I don't want to go on the long and winding road. I'm not really personally too interested in the journey. I'm not really too interested in seeing the scenery. I'm not really interested in stopping along the way unless it's out of necessity. And I know there's some other men that are just like that here this morning. I know you're there. I like to just get there. You know, for me, the journey is something, quite frankly, I want to get out of the way. I mean, we've made long journeys as families. We've traveled, you know, 15 hours, 17 hours, more than that at times, in one day, well, just to get there, because we want to get it over with. And especially when you have little kids. I remember one particular journey where it was in Saskatchewan, Canada. We lived in that area, and it was really, really cold. Remember that cold snap we had a few weeks back? It was akin to that, but worse. And we were driving in our minivan, the kids were really little, and my son Nathaniel decided that it was a good time on that trip to become sick, and so he was sick in the back seat, in the car seat, and of course we're in the middle of absolutely nowhere in the prairies in Saskatchewan driving along. Thankfully we knew that there was a gas station up ahead, and so we stopped at that gas station, and what do? You go in there, like, do you have anything to clean out, like, the whole car seat area? It's a mess. And the interior of the car just reeked, of course. It was horrible to drive in. And you can't unroll the windows because it's absolutely frigid outside. So what I did find, I don't know if they have this in the United States or not, but they had a bottle of what's called Pine Sol. Yeah, Pine Sol, right? Now, normally with Pine Sol, what do? You take the bottle of Pine Sol and you're supposed to, like, it's concentrate, right? You put it in and you mix it with a bunch of water and it's great stuff for cleaning. Well, we didn't have anything like that, so it was straight out pouring the bottle of Pine Sol. This was my idea, not my wife's, right into the car seat, into the cracks and everything to try to clean out things. And let me tell you that you never want to mix a child's throw up with Pine Sol. It's not a good idea. It actually made things even worse. And so what we did is we did drive the rest of the trip with the windows fully down, completely freezing, until we got to, I think it was Calgary, Alberta, Canada, where we stopped. But it was a horrible trip. And so our family over the years, probably like a lot of families, I would imagine, have encountered our share of troubles on the road. And they're during vacations. So the moment I leave my home on a vacation, I want everything to be just right. I don't want problems on vacation. Who does? And yet we would have vehicle breakdowns because we didn't always have nice vehicles. We would be stuck somewhere in a delay waiting for parts to arrive. We'd have sick kids. Every single vacation, there'd be some kid going to the emergency room for stitches or for strep throat or for something. Unplanned expenses that would take away what felt like limited financial resources to just go on a vacation. And the trials and the difficulties of that put us in a place where, for me at least, I'm like, I just want to get there. I just want... It's not about the journey, it's about the destination. Get me to the destination where I can enjoy. Man, life's not like that though, is it? When it comes to our spiritual life in particular, and life in general, we think about things, well, we think God does things radically different than that. That's the way I think about the journey. It's not the way God thinks about the journey. To God, the journey seems to be just as important as the destination. In some ways, you wonder even if it's more important to Him than the destination sometimes. He cares deeply about the journey through life, the spiritual journey that you and I are on. Because God uses the journey. to accomplish His purpose, His purposes in our lives. And from Scripture, what we discover is that God, with God, sometimes the best route or route, can't remember how to say that word now, sometimes the best route is not the shortest distance between two places, according to God. We think that's the best route, but God has a different plan altogether. We pick this up, for example, in Exodus, starting in Exodus chapter 12 in the Old Testament, the second book of the Bible, where Exodus chapter 12, we read that God led Israel, the nation of Israel, out of Egypt after 430 years of slavery. And His plan was to take them to the promised land, a land flowing, He describes, with milk and honey. Surely so much better than living in Egypt as slaves, where they were eating leeks and onions by the Nile. But what we discover is that God didn't take them on the shortest route. He set them free. He led them out of Egypt. But He didn't take them on the shortest route. Notice what God did. Here's our text for this morning. In Exodus chapter 13, verses 17 through 22, here's what we read. When Pharaoh let the people go, God did not lead them by way of the land of the Philistines, although that was near. For God said, lest the people change their minds when they see war and return to Egypt. But God led the people around by the way of the wilderness toward the Red Sea. And the people of Israel went up out of the land of Egypt equipped for battle. Moses took the bones of Joseph with him, for Joseph had made the sons of Israel solemnly swear, saying, God will surely visit you, and you shall carry up my bones with you from here. And they moved on from Succoth and encamped at Etham on the edge of the wilderness. And the Lord went before them by day in a pillar of cloud to lead them along the way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light, that they might travel by day and by night. The pillar of cloud by day and the pillar of fire by night did not depart from before the people. Did you catch that in the text? Did you catch it? That God did not lead them on the shortest, fastest, easiest route to the promised land? He did not lead them on the route that was the most logical or the most rational, at least from a human perspective. In fact, the route that God took them on was not the easy traveling road that actually exists in that area, that would take you. There's an actual road that takes you directly to the promised land. On this long route instead that He redirected them to, there were no highways, no bridges, no resources to supply their needs, no signs to direct their paths. There was nothing. It was pure wilderness. So instead of the fastest, quickest, easiest route, which, God, that is what I want, thank you very much, what we read here is that God led them into the wilderness. Really, God, you're going to lead us into the wilderness toward the Red Sea? And when we read about going into the wilderness, we must not think this way, because, you know, city dwellers, we kind of think this way a little bit, like, man, I cannot wait till summer. I can smell the barbecue already, friends. Like, get the barbecue going. We're going to get the camper loaded up, and we're going to head out, and we're going to go up to the bush somewhere, and we're going to get our favorite camping spot. We're going to unpack that thing, why people think that's fun. I'm not sure personally, but maybe you love that. And you go there. And why? To get away from all the crazy insanity of city life. But when we think of wilderness, that's not what we're supposed to think here. This is not the kind of wilderness that you and I might be thinking of in terms of, like, beautiful forests and trees and lakes and fishing boats and jet skis and things like that. It's not that at all. I mean, after all, if God was leading us into that, we'd be going, amen, thank you, Lord. Take me into the wilderness. No, the wilderness being talked about here is, in the Near East, it's characterized as being dry, desolate, and mostly rock and sand. It's rough, uneven. It's interlaced with, sure, some dry water courses that are there. It's not completely 100% barren, but it's pretty close to it. And I can tell you this, having been in Jordan, in the country of Jordan, where some of this account unfolds, and having been in a Toyota pickup truck sitting in the back and driving through nothing but sand in that area by the Aqaba, I can tell you that that is a wasteland. It's beautiful because, yes, I'm in a pickup truck, and I know it's going to get me quickly back to this camp that I was staying at called the Bedouin Camp. It was no Bedouin camp. It was like a glorified sort of like Middle Eastern somewhat hotel for, you know, us Westerners to go over there. I had air conditioning and the whole deal. But when I was there, I was thinking about the Israelites and thinking, man, how in the world did they survive this wilderness journey? Rough, uneven, difficult, barren wasteland. You see, it was into that kind of a wasteland that God led his people. I don't know if we have it in front of us, the screen not working. But there is a map that maybe you can see. There it is. If you look at the top of that map, you'll notice the Mediterranean Sea at the very top, and over to your left is Egypt, and you can see sort of the route of the Israelites. But you see up right by the Mediterranean Sea at the top of the map there, and then you see how the Mediterranean Sea swings up to Gaza and Ashkelon and Ashdod. You see, that's the Promised Land. And there is a route that goes directly from Egypt all the way across, right following the Mediterranean Sea, right into the Promised Land. It's a 4 to 5 day journey. So coming out of Israel, or coming out of Egypt, they were told, listen, you will have, when you get into the Promised Land, God's going to deliver you out of this 430 years of slavery. You'll be brought into a land that is milk and honey. And you're thinking to yourself, okay, how long is this journey to the Promised Land? It's going to be a 4 to 5 day journey, but it turns out not being a 4 to 5 day journey, because that wasn't God's plan. Oh, they're going to get to the Promised Land, no doubt about it. They're going to have the land of milk and honey at some point, but not in 4 to 5 days. And so as God redirects them and he sends them down into the wilderness, that wilderness is where you and I, just like the Israelites, ask the big question, God, where are you? Where are you right now in the wilderness? Where are you? This is where the Israelites begin to complain and grumble against God and complain and grumble against Moses. God, where are you? You said that we would have a land of milk and honey, and all we've got right now is nothing to eat, and we've got nothing to drink. The barren wasteland. Now, where is God in the wilderness then? Well, our text actually tells us this, doesn't it? You see, God didn't leave himself without witness to the nation of Israel in Exodus chapter 13, verses 21 and 22. Notice what it says. And the Lord went before them. He went before them by day in a pillar of cloud to lead them along the way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light. There he was, right there in their midst. Verse 22 says that he did not depart from before the people. He was always there. So even though God had led them into the wilderness, he never left them alone in the wilderness. Even though it felt as though he had abandoned them, deserted them, or forsaken them, there's no doubt that those feelings were there. You know, it's so much like that for us too, isn't it? We have our spiritual wilderness that we talk about, the wilderness of the soul, where sometimes we're led into a wilderness. God brings us to a place where we don't want to be. We would rather be anywhere else than in the wilderness. God, where are you? Oh, and he's there. But God, I feel abandoned, I feel deserted, I feel forsaken. It doesn't feel like it used to feel, God. You know, it used to be so close to me, and it used to be so vibrant and so alive, and what's happening. Part of God's work in our soul is actually by his design to withdraw a little bit from us sometimes. That sounds maybe a little bit odd. Like, why would God strategically withdraw from us? Why would he do that? That's not right, Cory. That's not biblical, but it is, you see. Because sometimes God has to withdraw from us in order for us to press into him. He does these things so that we actually become more dependent upon him, lean upon him. And here God gave Israel, in the midst of all of the wilderness, his visible presence. They could see the pillar of cloud in the day. They could see the pillar of fire at night. But all around them was barrenness and wasteland. So by God's design, Israel entered into this literal wilderness. And friends, by God's design, he also leads us into wilderness. We call it the wilderness of the soul. Sometimes we refer to it actually as, in some places, the dark night of the soul. We get to a place in our lives where we hit a wall. We don't know what it is that we're dealing with. It's not an easy place because the wilderness is not easy. It's a dry, desolate, barren place. It's a place of wandering sometimes, a place of struggle, a place of asking God, where are you? For some, it's a place of doubt and discouragement and disillusion, a prolonged season sometimes for people. But God's in the midst of it. And he's with us. You remember maybe that old poem? Do you remember that old poem, Mary Stevenson, Footprints in the Sand? Do you remember that? I'll read it to you again just in case you've forgotten. One night I dreamed I was walking along the beach with the Lord. Many scenes from my life flashed across the sky. In each scene I noticed footprints in the sand. Sometimes there were two sets of footprints. Other times there were one set of footprints. This bothered me because I noticed that during the low periods of my life, when I was suffering from anguish, sorrow, or defeat, I could see only one set of footprints. So I said to the Lord, "You promised me, Lord, that if I followed you, you would walk with me always. But I've noticed that during the most trying periods of my life, there has only been one set of footprints in the sand. Why? When I needed you the most, have you not been there for me?" And the Lord replied, "The times when you have seen only one set of footprints is when I carried you," right? Is when I carried you. You see, God does go before us in our wilderness. He's there. The important question for us to ask and to a degree to answer is, what is God doing in the wilderness? Why would God lead Israel into the wilderness? Why? Why would you do that, God? Didn't you promise that this life would be my best life now? No, I did not. God did not promise that. Didn't you promise that heaven would be here on earth? No, I did not. God did not promise that. So, God, what are you doing in the wilderness? Well, there are five things that I want to give you this morning. And I would suggest to you, in keeping with our deeper series, we're in a series called Deeply Rooted, that I believe these are five things that God does, that he did with Israel, that he also does with us. These are five reasons why, or things that God does to make us more deeply rooted. This is how you and I become more deeply rooted. You know, we've been through this series, we've been through several weeks of this series, and so much of this series rightfully has pointed out, if you want to be deeply rooted, God, you got to give us, please, we ask for you to give us a greater desire for you, greater religious affections, greater sense of awe, a greater hunger and thirst for you. Yes, that's where it all starts. And then we've talked about how, God, give us a greater delight in your word, a greater desire for your word, Lord. Help us to really be able to take joy in praying and coming to you, Lord, that we'd honestly and earnestly want to seek your face. That and so many other messages are all messages where they tell us of things that God has said to us. These are the things that you do if you want to be deeply rooted. There's actionable steps you and I take to be deeply rooted, right? But this message, in some respects, is not an actionable step for you and I to take. This message is a message basically about how God takes you deeper. You know, if you want to be deeply rooted, there's a responsiveness to the wilderness that's needed, right? That's what's needed. There's a responsiveness to it because God, by his design, not only created the means like prayer and desire for the word to help us to go deeper, but he will do a work. He will do the work that he knows you and I need that we wouldn't actually do ourselves. And that's where it's hard. So five things. What's God doing in the wilderness? Number one, first we discover that in the wilderness, he's orchestrating his plan. He is orchestrating his plan. In Genesis chapter 15, verses 13 and 14, long before Israel ever entered into Egypt, God had said to Abraham, "Know this for certain, that your descendants will be enslaved and mistreated for 400 years, but after that I will bring them out." You see, God had a plan. He knew long before Israel ever went into Egypt that they would be enslaved and mistreated. And he knew the exact time that he was going to deliver Israel out of slavery. He raised up Moses at just the right time to do that. And just as God had a perfect plan and was orchestrating that plan all along, so too he orchestrated Israel's deliverance out of Egypt. And when we come to our text this morning in Exodus 13, notice again in verse 17 and 18 that it's God that led them. The text tells us God led them. He's the one, in other words, who's orchestrating this. Nobody else is. When Pharaoh let the people go, God did not lead them. So he did not lead them in this direction. What does it say in verse 18? But God led the people around by the way of the wilderness. This is God orchestrated plan right here. God orchestrating this event. He's the one that's making this happen. Moses isn't directing the ship here. God is directing the ship. And he does the same with us, doesn't he? God leads us the same way. He orchestrates it. He has the plan. Now, you and I, our challenge always is that we don't get to see the plan. There's times when you think, "Lord, I'd love to see the plan." And there's times I'm like, "No, I don't think I want to see the plan. I couldn't handle the plan. If I saw the plan, my soul would become overwhelmed. And it's better I don't know the plan. I don't know what's happening tomorrow. It's better that way." But there's sometimes when you're in the wilderness, you just want to go, "Okay, when is this going to end? How am I going to get out of this? What's the purpose of this? Why? And what sometimes we have to remember is that it's almost like you're in your car, and if you've ever been driving in an absolutely thick fog, the dense fog, and you got your lights on, and all that you can see is maybe 5 feet in front of your car, and you got to slow that car down, don't you? You got to slow it way down. And what do you fix your eyes on? You fix your eyes on the road right in front of you and the line in the center of the road. And you just follow that, not straight shot, you follow that road that's already laid out for you, that's taking you to where you need to go, but you follow that line ever so carefully, everywhere it's leading you to go. And that's sometimes all you get to see with God is what's right in front of your face. Friends, that's trust, isn't it? That's us recognizing that, you know, God is the one who's absolutely in control. He's the one orchestrating his plan. Like Psalm 139, verse 16 says that God has ordained every day of our lives. He's written them in a book. He knows every one of our lives. He knows us inside and out. He knows the very number of hairs on your head, or for some of you that you don't have any. That's the first thing. He's orchestrating his plan. That's what he's doing in the wilderness. So if he takes you down into the wilderness, know that he's working a plan, and we grab hold of that by faith. Second, we discover that in the wilderness, he's not giving his people more than they can handle. He's not giving them more than they can handle. Notice in the text, verse 17, when Pharaoh let the people go, God did not lead them by way of the land of the Philistines, although that was near. Here's the reason why. For God said, lest the people change their minds when they see war and return to Egypt. God's rationale in this text for not taking them in a straight shot to the promised land is that these people are completely unprepared. They've been slaves for 430 years. They have no idea how to defend and protect themselves. If we give them the straight shot to go into the promised land, although it's a land of milk and honey and it would be so great, they're not going to last. They're going to be toast. They'll be decimated by the Philistines who occupy the land. They're going to see war and they're going to head back to Egypt because, man, it was a lot easier back in Egypt. At least we had the onions and the leeks by the Nile. You see, this is an act of mercy from God, actually. You know, by the Israelites, it's not interpreted as an act of mercy, though, is it? But by God's perspective, from his perspective, this is purely an act of his love and his mercy, not giving the Israelites more than they can handle. He knew that they would have trouble. Now, if we're honest with ourselves, as much as we like to quote, sometimes maybe out of context, even 1 Corinthians 10:13. If we're honest, sometimes life feels like it is more than we can handle. God doesn't give us more than we can handle? Really? Are you seriously saying that this morning, Cory? Do you know my life? I'm so above what I can handle. I'm so maxed out, so the threshold is just reached and breached. Well, the truth of the matter is you're right. God gives us things that we can't handle. We can't handle them on our own. Yeah, that's exactly the point, though, isn't it? Isn't that exactly the point that God gives his people, he's not giving them more than they can handle, but what is he doing? He's putting them into the wilderness where they will do what? Where they will look to him. He is their resource. That's the answer. The difficulties are there to point us to dependence upon God, not upon ourselves. But the Israelites had to learn that. Thirdly, we discover that in the wilderness, he is purifying his people through testing and trials. God led Israel into the wilderness to test them. Scripture makes that very clear. And in their testing, he was purifying them. You see, God was at work in his people. He was at work among his people. We see this in Deuteronomy chapter 8. This is 40 years after they've been wandering in the wilderness now. You see, remember initially God said to Israel, listen, leave the promised land, or leave Egypt, you'll go into a land of milk and honey. And it took them basically 2 years just to get to the border because God redirected them. After approximately 2 years, they sent in spies into the land. And because of their disobedience, God said, well, I guess you guys are going back into the wilderness again and you'll wander for 40 years total. And then at the end of 40 years in the book of Deuteronomy, here's what we're told by way of reflection upon those 40 years. In chapter 8, verse 1 and 2, the whole commandment that I command you today shall be, you shall be careful to do that you may live and multiply and go in and possess the land that the Lord swore to give to your fathers. And you shall remember, notice this phrase, the whole way that the Lord your God has led you these 40 years in the wilderness. Notice this purpose clause, starting with the word that he might humble you, testing you to know what was in your heart, whether you would keep his commandments or not. How can one read that text and not come away with the conclusion that the wilderness, all 40 years of it for Israel, was and is a God-ordained test for his people? And God plans and permits those kinds of tests in our lives as well, the trials and the testing that come, because these things, we are told in Scripture, have a way of purifying us, of purging us, don't they? Purging out of us the things that God wants removed from our lives. In 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 6 and 7, Peter said to the church, in this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you've been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. What Peter does in this passage is he contrasts our faith, our faith that's under trial, that's under testing, And he contrasts that with the process of purification, of purging out of gold any impurities that exist. Because you know, the goldsmith, what he would do is he would take the gold and he would hang it over or hold it over fire, the kind of fire that's so hot that the impurities of the gold are purged out, the what they call the dross is removed from the gold, so that all that is left is pure gold. You see, and that's the process. And you know, there's that old song. You remember that old song, Refiner's Fire? Refiner's Fire, my heart's one desire is to be holy. I don't like singing that song. I'll be honest with you. I don't like singing that song. You know, when you sing that song, when you sing lyrics, you got to ask yourself, do I really want this? Do I really think this and believe this? What you're saying when you're singing Refiner's Fire is you're saying, God, my one heart's desire is for you to purge and cleanse me. Like, God, bring the trouble in my life. Give me the trials. That's what we're asking for. Why? We're asking that why? Because we know that that's the process through which God actually really helps us to become deeply rooted. It's through the trials. It's through the suffering. It's through the affliction. And I don't know, it seems a little bit like insanity to pray that. You guys are looking at me like, you're insane. You know that I say that, but the reality is I know that that's what we need. But what we need, friends, is not what we want. What I need is not what I want. I don't want purging. I don't want cleansing like that. I don't want to be held over the fire, God. I don't want to go into the wilderness, God, of the soul. If you've been in the wilderness for any period of time spiritually, you know what I'm saying. You're like, so God, thank you that I'm out of the wilderness now. But friends, there's another wilderness coming. It's just a matter of time. I don't mean to discourage you this morning, but it's the reality of the spiritual life. If it's not this wilderness next week or the one you're in right now, there will be the ultimate wilderness called death when you finally enter into the promised land, and there you will lay down and you will have your land with milk and honey finally being in the presence of Jesus. Then you and I will have that, but not until then, right? Oh, God, help us. Help me, Lord. Number five, four, we discover that in the wilderness, he is teaching his people to trust him as their God. Notice this in chapter 8 of Deuteronomy as well, verse 3 and 4. And he humbled you and let you hunger and fed you with manna, which you did not know, nor did your fathers know, that he might make you know that man does not live by bread alone, but man lives by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. Your clothing did not wear out on you, and your foot did not swell in those 40 days. What is all of this saying? It's showing that God in the wilderness was teaching his people to trust him for all their provisions. I mean, they went in there. There was no resources to supply them. They didn't have their Visa card, their MasterCard, their whatever card. They didn't have their 401k to all of a sudden call upon an emergency if they needed to make an auto. You know, they didn't have any of that. They didn't have bread. They didn't have ovens. They didn't have nothing. Wow. Nothing like being stripped of absolutely everything in your life to be brought into a place of absolute dependence and trust. And they didn't do well, did they? They didn't do well. But then quite honestly, sometimes neither do we. But God loves us in the midst of it. Number five, we discover that in the wilderness, he is conforming his people to the image of Christ. In Romans chapter 8, we read these words, oh, very familiar words of Scripture, and we know that, and this is an important part of the text, for those who love God, it's for them, for those that love God, all things work together for good. What are the things that God works together for good? One of the great Puritans of old, a man named Thomas Watson, wrote an entire book on this called All Things for Good. I highly recommend it to you. It's a little Puritan paperback, and they are the masters of the soul. They will take the scalpel, and they will do spiritual surgery in you like they do in me when I read them. You see, it's those Puritans like Thomas Watson who said that all things, what are the all things? That is all the good things. all of the good things and all of the bad things. God is taking all of those things. For those that love God, all things, he is the one who's working those things together for good. It's like Dr. John Barkman, the guy that mentored me years ago when I was in Bible college, said. He was preaching one time and he said, this is it's a lot like carrot cake. It's a lot like carrot cake. He said that he loves carrot cake. It's his favorite cake. And he talked about how he asked his wife, so what's all in the carrot cake? He got the ingredients from her, and it was like oil or something, and butter and flour and spices and eggs and carrots and vanilla, nuts, sugar, stuff like that. And his comment was basically, boy, I sure love carrot cake, but on their own, there's a number of those ingredients that I do not want to consume on their own. I mean, oil? Flour on its own? No, thank you very much. But his point was to say that, you know, when those are all mixed together, when his wife puts that all into the whatever they do and they cook it up and our wives do that magic that they do, and voila, it comes out of wherever and it's there, you and I go, wow, you worked all things together for good, right? In kind of a lame way of illustrating that, that's God too, right? He takes all the good and he takes all the bad and he's working them all things together. He's working them all together. He takes the trials, the hardships, the sufferings, and the afflictions. Of these afflictions, Thomas Watson, here's what he had to say. Affliction teaches us to know ourselves. In prosperity, we are for the most part strangers to ourselves. We see that corruption in our heart is in the time of affliction. We see, he says, that corruption in our heart in the time of affliction, which we would not believe was there. Like in affliction, it brings it out, right? And then he states, water in the glass looks clear, but set it on fire and the scum boils up. When I was in Bible college, we were in the college in the middle of the prairies, and I started drinking coffee in college. And I had at the foot of my bed a coffee maker, and so I had it ready to go. So I would get up and I'd press the button, and then back down again. And then I would listen to it do its thing, and then I would get up, and then I would get my cup. I'd open up the lid, I'd take a spoon, and I would take the scum off the top, because the water was so hard, it was this nasty scum, and I didn't have it black because it was just nasty tasting coffee, so I had to load it up with all the other good stuff, right, to make it taste half decent, and that's how I started drinking. But you see, that's the idea, right? That boil the water, and what happens? The scum comes to the surface. And Watson is basically saying, you know, water in the glass looks clear, but set it on fire, and the scum boils up. He says, in prosperity, a man seems to be humble and thankful. Seems to be. The water looks clear. But set this man a little on the fire of affliction, and the scum boils up. Much impatience and unbelief appear. Oh, says a Christian, I never thought I had such a bad heart as now I have. I never thought my corruptions had been so strong and my grace is so weak. In prosperity, you see, the heart cleaves partly to God and partly to the world. And what God does now is he takes away the world that the heart may cleave to him more sincerely. Boy, that's what God's doing with Israel in the wilderness. That's what he's doing. Boy, I can look great in the midst of prosperity. But the true heart and the true soul and the true self needs a lot of work still. And God, in his great love for us, designs the wilderness to help us, right? To help us. So that's what God does in the wilderness of the soul. He takes us deeper. The problem that Israel faced, as you read the account in Exodus, starting on through chapter 13, 14, and 15, is that Israel, as you may well know, responded really poorly in the wilderness. Every time I read that account, I think to myself, yeah, I would be totally beside myself if that was me. I mean, I'd be like, Moses, where's the Starbucks? I mean, come on. I need my morning coffee. Where's the Chick-fil-A? So they're in the wilderness, right? And they're responding poorly to the wilderness. What do they do? Like, I think in your notes I have this, Israel grumbled against Moses, didn't they? You see this all through Scripture. I gave you just some of the Scripture. Israel complains against God in the wilderness. They turn against God and they worship other gods. They repeatedly test God until God has finally had it. And he drives them back into the wilderness for 40 more years. So what do we learn from Israel? What we learn is that when God leads us into the wilderness, there's a responsiveness that he's wanting to elicit from us. He's not leading us into the wilderness to harm us, to hurt us, but he does lead us into the wilderness of the soul at times because he's wanting to do a work in us. And so this morning, what I want to do in closing this message is to ask the question, what should we do in our wilderness? What should we do? Just a few thoughts for you to ponder and consider. First of all, just to ask you this morning, is that where you are? Are you in a wilderness place? It's hard. Wilderness times that I've been in, I can just testify that I have not enjoyed a single moment in the wilderness. I have, at times when I've been in the wilderness, felt so deserted, felt so isolated and alone, lonely, like a failure. Anxiety, depression, fear, waiting. God puts you in a wilderness where you're just waiting. His voice isn't loud and clear, maybe like it once was. Just because he's not talking doesn't mean he's not there. He's there. But boy, all of those things really unsettle us, right? But in some respects, friends, they're meant to unsettle us. They're meant to unsettle us. So if you're there this morning, then maybe this be a little balm for your soul. But if you're not there this morning, just know that the wilderness is coming. The wilderness is coming. And when it comes, remember these things. Number one, God led you into the wilderness, and he'll be with you through the wilderness. God did. He's leading you into it. He's permitting you to go through the wilderness of the soul. Number two, if you're in the wilderness, it does not necessarily mean that you've done something wrong. Oh boy, when we're in the wilderness, it's easy to think, what have I done, God? Why are you so far from me? Why are you so distant from me? How have I not? Have I somehow displeased you in some way? It's a good question to ask, but my friends, if we fixate upon that, when we've asked God to reveal and he doesn't, and we haven't have a revelation in terms of like, this is what you've done, repent, then sometimes you're just there because by God's design, he wants you there. And he will hold you there. Number three, if you're in the wilderness, you must remember that it's a season and it will likely pass. If it doesn't pass in this life, there is eternity, right? There is an ultimate end. But seasons do come and seasons go. There's a wilderness of the soul. Our lives have fall and winter and spring and summer to them. Anybody that's been around long enough in the spiritual life knows that it's all not spring. It's not all summer. That's a fictitious Christianity is what that is. You see, God's with you in all four seasons. But the various seasons require us to interface with God perhaps differently. Remember, number four, that God wants you to go through the wilderness, so don't try to escape it. Oh boy, it's so easy to want to escape the wilderness. I got to get out of here, and I got to get out of here as fast as I can. And my experience in trying to escape the wilderness, it just led to more frustration. Oh, and I had a friend who one time said to me, Cory, why are you kicking against the goads? Which is something that was said to the Apostle Paul. Why are you fighting this? Why are you throwing yourself down on the floor like you're a two-year-old, a toddler, having a tantrum, telling God, God, get me out of the wilderness! Are you done? Okay. Sometimes it's like that. You see, that's an issue of surrender and yieldedness, isn't it? It's God, help me to embrace where you have me. Number five, know that God has a purpose for your wilderness. He's at work in teaching you to trust him. And he's purifying you to be more like him. God uses those wilderness things in your life to make you and I more deeply rooted. His goal is to form character in us, right? That we would, as Romans says, be conformed to the image of Christ. And then lastly, during your wilderness journey, keep doing the things that will help you to be deeply rooted. Don't put your foot off the gas in terms of praise and prayer and the word and community, fellowship. All of those in the wilderness are absolutely critical to continue with. For by God's design, those are the things that actually help us so much through the wilderness. So friends, even out of the barren, dry, and desolate wasteland of our wilderness, God can bring the greatest growth and fruitfulness in our lives. He is the one who can make us deeply rooted. All we have to do is say, Lord, I surrender. I yield to your perfect will over my life. Let's pray. Lord, this morning we are standing in your presence, Lord, and we just acknowledge that, Lord, we really are desperately in need of you. Lord, oh, how my heart so longs to have heaven on earth, even though I know that that's not the reality and that's not your plan. So, Lord, in our afflictions, in our discomfort, in our sufferings, in our trials and hardships, Lord, in all of the things that come into our lives, whether they are short and momentary or whether they are prolonged, Lord, whether they are wildernesses that seem to stretch on, Lord, we surrender to you. We surrender all to you. And Lord, help us not to miss what you're doing in those wilderness times, that we would gladly yield to your sovereign hand in bringing about your purposes in our lives for your good and for your glory. For we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.